Hi everyone, my name is Sunil Kumar and I am from the Indirect Tax R&D team of Taxman. I hope you all are healthy and safe. So today I have recorded this discussion regarding the recent ongoing issue on the taxability of various transactions between an employer and employee. The recent order of Maharashtra Authority of Advance Ruling has provided that when an employer recovers a nominal amount from the employee in relation to transportation facility, the same cannot be brought to tax because of Schedule 3, Clause 1. But this Schedule 3, Clause 1 provides? Schedule 3, Clause 1 provides that when an employee provides services to the employer in the course or in relation to the employment, the same would neither be treated as supply of goods nor supply of services. Therefore, no tax. So in this discussion, we would be discussing a very important principle called as condition under the contract. This principle would really going to help us a lot in determining the taxability of various transactions between an employer and employee. So before discussing this principle, let us have an understanding of the employment arrangement, and then we will discuss a bit about the relevant legal provisions of the GST law, which impacts the taxability of transactions between these two persons, and then we'll come on to this conceptual part. So if you see the employment contract or employment arrangement, we would find that an employer provides various facilities, various services to its employees. For example, I am working in Taxman. The company has provided me the laptop to work. The company has allotted me the workstation, so I am using furniture there. The room where I sit, there is AC, so I am using the AC facility. Can I say that these are the services provided by the company to me and therefore it is exigible to GST? And apart from this, you would also find that there are certain obligatory mandated activities or facilities which are required to be provided by the employer to the employees, and these are mandated under the labor laws. For example, canteen services, transportation facilities, pick up and drop from office to home and vice versa. So can we say that these are the services provided by the employer to employee and therefore tax should be levied on the same? So this is something which we would be going to discuss, right? Okay, so section 15 of the GST Act, explanation to section 15, provides that the employer and employee are related parties. Clause 2 of Schedule 1 provides that supply between related parties would be treated as supply and subject to GST even if there is no consideration between the parties. Okay, so if employer is providing any supply to the employee, services or maybe goods, it would be subject to GST even if he is not charging anything from the employee, right? We also have Schedule 3, as we discussed while discussing the Maharashtra Authority of Advance Ruling Order, that services provided by the employee to the employer in the course or in relation to the employment, it would not be treated as supply. One may say, since we do not have any consideration in the contract, then on what value we would be required to pay tax if it is to be paid? So for that, there are certain specific valuation provisions, Rule 28, which provides certain mechanism, methods, which would help us to determine the value. So we do not need to bother about that, how valuation can be done. Valuation can be done in this case. Okay. So let us come on to the important part of this discussion, condition under the contract. As I said to you, that this concept would really going to help us a lot while determining the taxability of these two persons in relation to transactions between these two persons. So To understand this concept, let us go back to the service tax regime. So we have a very important judgment under the erstwhile service tax regime, Delhi Tribunal Larger Bench, Bayana Builders. The facts of the case were, in that case, there was a service provider who was engaged in provision of construction services. He entered into a contract with the service recipient, where service recipient was obliged to provide certain goods to the service provider in order to complete the contract. And these goods enables the service providers to perform his part under the contract. Right, okay. So the question before the larger bench was whether these goods which are provided by the recipient to the supplier, can it be called as additional consideration and can it be brought to tax or not? Right, okay. So, Delhi Tribunal, the larger bench, analyzed the meaning of consideration first under the Indian Contract Act while referring Section 16, valuation provision of the service tax regime. The meaning of the consideration they have adopted from the Indian Contract Act, Section 2D, which provides that when at the desire of the promisor, the promising does or abstains from doing, etc., etc., something, such act would be called as consideration for the promise. So there are certain important points in this definition. First, if there is a desire of the promisor that I would want something from you in respect of the act which I'll do for you, right? And the desire must be for the promise. Okay, so under the construction contract, which we have just discussed, under the construction contract, maybe one can say that it is a desire of the service provider to receive the goods, but this is the desire under the contract. It is not for the promise. For the promise, I have received the consideration amount, the amount which I agreed with the service recipient, that is a consideration for me. Okay, so that is a desire for me. Therefore, that can only be called as consideration under the contract. While analyzing the judgment, while forming the view, the larger bench has also referred an Australia GST ruling where the concept of condition under the contract was discussed. That ruling provides that under a particular contract, there can be multiple conditions. And certain condition can be like where recipient put forth certain condition on himself that, okay, I'll make certain things available to you, which enables you to perform your part in the contract. So that ruling provides that this activity of making available certain things to the service provider cannot be called as consideration for the service provider. It cannot be called as a consideration. Okay, in another words, I can say that nothing has been supplied by service recipient to the service provider. Fine, because these goods are something which are provided to complete the contract. I have not supplied to the service provider. Let's take another example. Suppose I have hired a painter to paint a particular wall for a sum of rupees 1000. I said to him that, okay, I'll pay you some rupees 1000. And under the contract, I have also agreed that, okay, the paint which is required for this activity, I'll make available to you. So from painter's perspective, can I say that this paint is consideration for him? Obviously not. It is not a consideration for him because his desire for his activity, for his promise, was to receive the monetary consideration of rupees 1000. It is not the desire for the promise to receive these goods. It can be desire under the contract, but it is not a desire for the promise. And the promise was to paint the wall, right? Okay, so this cannot be called as consideration. And also साइमल्टेनियसली आई कैन से दिस कि दिस इज नॉट द सप्लाई फ्रॉम द रिसिपियंट्स एंड. सो द पेंट विच आई हैव सप्लाई विच द पेंट विच आई हैव मेड अवेलेबल टू द पेंटर, इट इज नॉट अ सप्लाई फ्रॉम माई साइड. ओके, दिस इज नॉट अ सप्लाई फ्रॉम माई साइड. ओके, सो वट वी अंडरस्टूड फ्रॉम दिस कॉन्सेप्ट, वी अंडरस्टूड दैट अंडर अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट देयर कैन बी मल्टीपल कंडीशंस एंड सर्टेन कंडीशंस कैन बी लाइक वेयर द रिसिपियंट हैज पुट फोर्थ सर्टेन कंडीशंस ऑन हिमसेल्फ, स्टिपुलेशंस ऑन हिमसेल्फ दैट ओके इन ऑर्डर टू कंप्लीट द कॉन्ट्रैक्ट आई मेक सर्टेन थिंग्स अवेलेबल टू यू दैट making that provision of the services or availability of goods cannot be called as consideration, and I can also say that cannot be called as a supply by the recipient to the service provider. Okay, now if we apply this concept under the employment arrangement, what can we say? So I'll say that to work I need a laptop. To work efficiently, I need a workspace. So I'm using the workstation, using the furniture. The room where I sit to maintain the temperature of the room so that I can work efficiently, I need the AC. Therefore, I would say that these are not the services provided by the employer to me. Rather, these are the stipulation under the employment contract which makes available by the employer to me, and it enables me to work effectively. Rather, it enables me to work also. Okay, so therefore it cannot be called as supply. Now if you see in industry, there are generally three types of transactions available. First, where the employer provides certain services to the employee for which he does not charge anything. Okay, there can be another types of arrangement where employee provides certain services or goods, supply goods for which he charges from the employees. And there is third case also where partial recovery is made. So in first case where he is not charging anything from the employee, we can say that this is under the condition of the employment, and therefore it cannot be brought to tax because there is no supply by the employer to the employee. It is the stipulation under the employment contract. It enables the employee to work. Okay, but obviously facts of the case needs to be seen. We cannot directly conclude, but this logic, this concept would really going to help you to determine the taxability. For example, if I will say that I deal in X product and I have supplied that product to my employee, can I say this should be brought to tax? It can be brought to tax if it is not under the employment contract. It is not required for the employment. Okay, so in this case, yes, it is taxable. So therefore, the facts of the case needs to be seen and then conclusion can be drawn, but this principle would really going to help you. The another case where I'm saying that okay, I'll charge from the employee, and charge is basically on the open market value, the true value. In that case, I would say that there is a commercial aspect involved into it, and the employer has deliberately supplied something to the employee. Therefore, it should be taxed. Third case where partial recovery is made, and here comes the confusion generally. In that regard, I would say, to the extent the amount which I have recovered from the employee, that is only the supply under the contract. And the amount which I have not received from the employee, that is on account of employment. Therefore, that amount which I have not received, you cannot say that it should be brought to tax. Again, the facts of the case needs to be seen. If it is not under the employment arrangement or not required for the employment to perform the employment, then you can say that it is not taxable. Therefore, fact of the case needs to be seen. but the facilities, for example, the AC, laptop, furniture which I am using, you cannot call these types of transaction that it would be subject to tax, because these are the facilities provided by the employer to me. In a similar way, I can also say for the canteen that if I am not charging anything from the employee, then it is a facility extended by me to the employee so that he can work properly. It can be called as under the employment arrangement. Fine. So this is all from my side. I believe that this would really going to help you. Thank you. Thanks a lot.